folks, I am glad to be here. Hope you are too. I have Stephen Payshee of Payshee's Popcorn, and they are joining me to share a ton of stuff to help you out, maybe inspire you to go, you know what, I'm going to turn off the TV, quit complaining about the government and the different, you know, political parties and all the things that stress us out and our adult kids who are idiots, and start living life a little bit. I'm not ashamed to say that, Steve, that I have some idiot children. It's just when they got more of my wife's genes, I think. And she's over here sending me live emojis right now, and I'm not going to show you what that looks like.
I'm the idiot. My daughter's a genius.
Oh, I tell you what, I was smart when I was 21. I should have wrote like 10 books.
Oh, yeah.
I knew way more than my parents.
Yeah. Stephen King said 19, man. You know everything.
You know everything. Go ahead and write it all down. We have got Barbara here, Kenneth here, Hot Diggity Meatballs and Dogs. I have never heard that name, and I freaking love that. Hot Diggity Meatballs and Dogs. That's a great name.
It is.
Angela's here, Jason's here, Art Make Peace is here. Isn't that a cool last name, Make Peace?
Yes.
I like that. And that's his real name. Mr. Poor Sam Amato, we're going to change that. He's going to be Rich Sam Amato next week. And are doing all right, Sam Amato. Nobody in the South says they're rich. You know, everybody says I'm doing all right. Even the rich people, they're like, how you doing? Man, things are all right, I guess. You know, they don't tell you they just want, you know, won the lottery for $8 million. That is right. Barely getting by. It's called poor mouthing, we call it here.
Yep.
Michael Wood is here listening live. Anyway, right. I want to ask y'all some questions. I appreciate you coming on. You have no idea how you doing this inspires others, and it shares real life things going on. So if y'all don't mind, tell me how this even came to be. What was the genesis of Payshee's Popcorn?
You want to start?
Not really, because it's not Steve's popcorn.
All right, I'll start.
I'll let you start on that.
I always liked making popcorn, and so it's kind of silly, but I work for a bank, and I have a desk job, and it's kind of hard, stressful. And we were just sort of sitting in the back room one day a few years ago saying, what would we like to do when we grow up? And I said, well, one of the happiest things I've actually ever done is make popcorn for people. I used to do it at my son's school carnivals when he was little. And I just remember how positive an experience it was. Every time you hand someone a bag of popcorn, they're happy. They're never angry with you. They're never upset. You always get a smile. And it's a simple transaction. There are no contracts. There are no indemnifications or warranties or guarantees, except if you don't like it, I'll give you our money back. So that's one of the reasons we wanted to do it. And also, we like to cook. I make all my own seasonings. And so that's fun and creative for me. And that's really how it started. The rest of it has been a bit of a journey. So, a journey learning what not to do and what to do.
Yeah, so y'all shared a blog article, y'all shared with me an entire how you got started, detail by detail, and obviously, whoever writes that, I think it's Steve, right?
Yep.
Has a sense of humor, great, I like using the word prose, which, you know, I just learned that, but it basically means the words you wrote or said. If y'all want to see that, it's at learnhotdogs.com, and it's how we did popcorn under the cottage food laws. I'm showing it there on the screen just so you can see. They shared everything you can imagine, from their first time setting up to their everything. I mean, talking about their whirly pop and And I got a picture of that. No detail is spared.
We have it here.
No, check that out. I love it. I'm going to put me back up here. There's the Whirly Pop.
Yep. That's the magic machine. Awesome. It's now kaput.
Is it? Yeah. You done with it?
Just wore it out like this weekend because we had some extra bags to make because I didn't make I miscalculated with the big kettle, and so we'll make them in the kitchen, and so we were in the middle of that. And
I think we need to give away.
Barely made it.
I think, I talked about giving away a Whirly Pop and that popcorn machine you showed me, the one that is a little fancier, like a movie theater deal. We're going to give those away here on the show or on this interview. Everything I call a show, I can argue with one of my adult daughters, and it's a show because it is a show. It's like Jerry Springer reincarnate.
I don't know if I like that.
So take me from what happened there. Then once you said, okay, I'm going to do this. How did this keep going, and where are you now? Kind of deal.
Well, I'll give you a fast forward version because it's definitely a disco long version of it. But we first started out, the first idea was she wanted to have some kind of cart / trailer that looks, sort of like the turn of the century, popcorn.
Like the Creeders carts.
Creeders back in the day, 100 years ago. And, that we pulled behind our car or something because we wanted a low carbon footprint. It was part of our original idea. It still is. And our car is a hybrid. Unfortunately, you can't put a towing package on it because it's a hybrid. And all
we learned that.
And so then we went on this whole journey of like, what are we going to do? And we got cute. We're going to put it on a golf cart city, nix that. I mean, we ran roadblock after roadblock after roadblock, and I think I went through some of that in one of the articles. But eventually we ended up buying two Polaris GEM trucks. It's like little flatbed trucks. They're electric from Minnesota Vikings, actually. And we wanted to buy one, but we basically got two for less than the price of a new one.
It was just a guy who knows a guy who knows a guy who knows a guy at the Vikings. That's right. How it came together.
Anyway, we ended up with two of them. We sold one of them, long story short. And the idea we were going to build out the back of it, the front of it's, it's totally cute. It's electric, kind of modern looking. And the back was going to be, 100 years old looking, it's old fashioned. And so we submitted that to, Department of Ag.
Okay.
To get like some kind of mobile food unit license or something. And it fell between their check boxes.
They did not say yes.
And they nixed it, or they basically said we had to have, four sinks, the deal.
Hot water heater.
Hot water, all this on the back of this little truck. And we're like, there's no way that's going to happen. And by that point, it was almost time for, the summer season to start up. And we're like, man, we're dead in the water. So then we're like, my boss at the farmer's market reminded me of cottage food, which I should have known all along. And so then we were like, okay, let's just do that. And we'll get started at least.
Right. But that became a completely new thing to work through. To make cottage food very, very different from trying to pop something live. That was always the goal, was to do live popcorn popping, hand someone a fresh, hot bag of popcorn. That was next by the Department of Ag. They did not care for our plan review. So then we talked to Molly. So shout out to Molly, friend. She's the manager of the farmer's market. And she said, you know what? You should just do cottage food. You got to do it. You just got to do it. Figure it out. So we figured it out, and we didn't do it right the first couple of times. The first time we brought it to the market, it was terrible. It was a humid day, and we had everything in a paper bag because we're trying to be eco-friendly. Well, popcorn is susceptible to the atmosphere around it. So if it's humid and you don't have it in plastic, it will be gross. And it was, but we showed up last week again
it wasn't perfect. So
yeah, well, we had to change our plan so that we could deliver a product that was fresh and good.
Yeah.
And it just has continued to evolve since then.
Well, tell me a little about that, but first I have a question, otherwise I'll forget this. Brian asks, he's got classic kettle corn, and what is the name of the bonding oil you made mention of in your first interview? It was when you sent me the video.
Well, we pop, I'm not sure exactly what he's asking. I mean, we pop everything, this from the beginning, in organic cold-pressed coconut oil.
Okay.
However.
But to do like the cheeses and the other flavors that you have to toss, non-kettle corn stuff, we then spray those with a couple of different things depending on the flavor. The main one we use is a blend of avocado and sunflower oil.
We also use olive oil
on one particular flavor,
and we also use organic ghee on some of the other flavors,
which okay. is clarified butter, basically.
And it's shelf stable.
The beauty of the ghee is that the first time when we first make, we did a classic popcorn, butter and salt, right? And we used butter, and it was kind of soggy. You know, because butter has water content. Yeah, it's water, the whey and the water content, and the ghee does not. So it's just the oil and the fat, and
it's really expensive if you get good stuff. Because some ghee tastes really bad.
Don't buy the discounted ghee.
No, you must get the good stuff.
I use ghee in my pie crust. Because it doesn't, you don't have to be as careful making it. Right. So when I do pies, normally you'd have to go to either a cold plate or put it in the fridge real quick and then bring it back out and chop some more and dice up your butter because the butter melts. And then I learned, okay, well, I can go with European butter, higher fat content. It stops that soggying up the flour.
And ghee totally does.
And ghee is perfect for it. So I started using a little bit of butter and a lot of ghee, and I ended up with a perfect pie crust. So you use ghee to flavor, which creates a unique flavor because ghee is, you're getting all butter. I mean, you're getting the best part of the butter.
It's clarified butter.
The only one we used to use that, well, two things we used to use it on. We use it for what we call the classic, which is just butter and salt.
Mm-hmm.
We use it for that. And then we also use it in another tossed flavor, which is a cha-cha churro, which was, back then anyway, it was a powdered sugar cinnamon thing. And we use the ghee to bind that.
And Madagascar bourbon vanilla powder.
Yep, and that one. It was pretty fabulous.
Vanilla. Yes. Now you just said vanilla powder, and a minute ago when we were talking before this started, I don't remember you mentioning powder to me.
Powder is another form of vanilla.
I didn't know that existed.
Yeah, it's usually used to make ice cream. It's very expensive, but it is really delicious.
And what are your
flavor?
Payshee, what is your plans going forward? You're in Steve's plans. Heading forward, is it to do? I know we have COVID, so tell us first how that's affected you and what you had to do, back up and punt, or did y'all just retire and go to the islands for a few months? What you been doing?
No islands
around. Well, there are islands, but they're really
there's the
cold.
Center island in the kitchen. That's about it.
That's the closest the island as we're gonna get. It was tough, because we were really planning. This last, this year in the spring to finish getting our seasonal temporary food stand license so we could pop, kettle corn live finally. That we, for 2 years, we did cottage food. And we were getting kind of burnt out on doing that in the kitchen every week. So, we still wanted to do live popcorn. And we had put through our license stuff, and we got the preliminary agreement. You know, yep, that's good. That's just buy the equipment, and we'll have the inspection, right? And then, you know, March came along, and COVID came, and we were like, and we didn't really have the cash at the moment to get all the equipment we needed to get the license, and we were like, I don't know if we want to let you know, borrow money to get all of that
during COVID.
During COVID, because we like everybody, we didn't know what the hell was going to happen. So we're like, okay, we're just going to take this season off.
Yep.
And I was still working at farmers market, and of course we were opening a farmers market in the middle of COVID, and that was stressful enough. And so we were doing that all summer, and then I guess it was in August. Payshee's like, well, I think we could find the money for the machine if we want to do it. And I was like, let's just do it. And so we did. We ordered a big 160 quart North Bend kettle corn machine with the and all that stuff. And we started, you know, once we got it here and got it cranked up, we did a couple of secret kind of speakeasy events here in the driveway.
Speakeasy popcorn events.
Yeah, well, we had luckily, I mean, not this wasn't all luck, it was planning. We had built up an email list, not a huge one, I mean, like 100 or so people. And pretty good Facebook following. And you know, I sent out, you know, it wasn't even public event. I mean, it was on Facebook, it was private, and the email went to the email list and nobody else. We told them, hey, it's just you. Come out. And we didn't even charge them that first time, I think. Just come out and eat some popcorn. And it's because we don't really know what we're doing yet. We're just testing this machine out. And that was cool. It was fun. And they all enjoyed it. And then we did a couple more things after that. And then we got ready for holiday popcorn, which we just finished.
He forgot to tell you about our experiment with jalapeno popcorn, which, by the way, the idea of it is super cool, and it's going to be delicious when we figure it out. However, we did almost napalm half the neighborhood. We had people running and screaming away.
It was chemical.
It was like
warfare.
We made pepper spray. But that was interesting. We have to fine tune that a bit.
Yeah, I would imagine. that's cool as heck. I wanted to put this up. If you got a question, ask in the comments. We are talking with, if you just joined us, Payshee's Popcorn. This is Stephen Payshee. They have shared a ton of their knowledge. They're not newbies. They've been at this for over 2 years and have started with the cottage food, ran that for 2 years. And you can get all the nitty-gritty details for free at learnhotdogs.com. It's one of the first articles there on the front page. I just got it up recently. And wait till you read it, because, one, it's entertaining as you go, because Steve has a great sense of humor. And he's good with his prose. See, I got to use that word. See, that's dumbfounding people. Wait till I use that at the next family reunion.
That's nice. They were prose. Prose is as opposed to poetry.
Right.
But right. But they will look at me like I'm speaking another language.
Yeah.
And
it's called English.
English.
Let's see. Do you do caramel corn too?
We do.
She makes the best on the planet.
We don't make it in the kettle. It's a totally different process. And we do it once a year just for holiday corn. We don't sell it the rest of the year because it is very, like I said, it's a specialized process.
It's a pain in the ass.
But does it sell good? And do you like something like that, Payshee, where you have put in a lot of effort on one certain type of product, ingredients and stuff? Do you charge more for those?
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Definitely.
We for sure do. Like a regular bag of, like a small bag of our kettle corn is $6. For our caramel corn, it would probably be $12 for the same.
Oh yeah, for like slightly less than a gallon.
Which almost pays for the cost of that fancy vanilla I showed you earlier.
Yeah. Which is one of the key ingredients.
It is. Yeah.
I'm gonna show a picture here. This is, and I'll try to make this bigger for everybody. This is them with their bags. You have a secret with your bags, though, that you taught us in the article you wrote, Steve. Do you mind sharing that real quick, that your double bagging deal?
Oh, yeah. Well, she kind of alluded to that at the beginning. We were the first time out, we just used the paper bag that you see there, the outer bag.
Which is just a bakery bag.
Right. It's just a bakery bag. It does have a little bit of wax, you know, coating on it. But
we didn't want to use plastic if we could help it.
That's right. We're trying to avoid it. But it was June, right? And even in Minnesota, it gets a little bit humid. And so we went, it was a little bit soggy, especially the classic popcorn. And so then the next week we went with, you know, I went and got a bunch of, you know, basically like 2 gallon Ziplocs.
Yeah. Some Reloc bag.
Yeah, and we used those, and then we found, you know, some cheaper ones.
Ziplocs were not the cheapest. No. That's the caramel picture right there.
Yeah, that's the caramel actually being poured onto the popcorn, and I'm getting ready to mix. I'm the mixer.
Yeah.
You taught me something new, and I want to break in there because you – and I've never known this. I've pitched mushroom popcorn. It's all I ever tried, but I tried every brand of mushroom popcorn since the beginning. And then you taught me something new, and I have yet to try it, but it makes sense. Logically makes sense that you have more surface area in what you talked about.
With butterfly?
With regular butterfly popcorn has all those little things. Okay, there's little nooks and crannies in it where you get flavor. And that just makes much better sense.
It's more delicate. So it's easier for it to get broken up.
Right. When you're stirring. Little wings can break off.
Right.
When you're stirring, or, you know, it's mainly, I mean, I think it does fantastic in the kettle, the big kettle with like the sugar and all that. Mm-hmm. Because the sugar kind of solidifies on it and kind of protects it. So when you're knocking it around on the sifting table, it doesn't really break up that much. But I mean, the tough one is like in the caramel corn. I have to stir around, you know, and this is the stirrer, my arm right here. We don't have a mixer.
I'm the mixer. Jeez.
So it's like, you got to mix it. You got to be delicate, and you got to keep spinning the bowl and all this stuff. I mean, it's work. But it is amazing stuff. And I forget how good it is until every December when we make it again. And I'm like, oh my God, you cannot stop it.
We actually call it Christmas crack, which I know a lot of other people have.
That's a great name though. I've never heard Christmas crack.
We have two flavors that we developed a couple years ago. I mean, the plain caramel, we mix it with like the cheese, our cheese popcorn. So it's kind of like the mix from Illinois that we can't mention because they have a copyright on the name, but we call it St. Paul Sweet. And then we have what we call the December Decadence. And it's caramel corn, and then we drizzle it with white or dark and then white chocolate.
We also include gluten-free pretzel pieces.
Right.
Because our company is 100% gluten-free because my dad's a celiac, so I wanted to make snacks that he could eat for him. Everything could be totally safe for him.
He's also diabetic, so he can't eat too much of it.
Yeah.
right. So unflavored popcorn.
Right. He likes the classic.
Butter is our favorite, actually.
Okay, so a few questions, and some of these I'll help with. What do you do when you live in a state that says no to everything on a cart? Jan, this is a great question, but this doesn't have to be on a cart. They're working under the cottage food laws. I am currently working. I have a lot of information on that already, but I'm currently working on all 50 states. I'll have it done by Christmas Eve, and it will go live. And it's a state by state, so that you only have to look at your state and find out what you can do. And even when your state says no, like New Jersey, I give you all the loopholes, the legal loopholes, not something that's going to get you arrested. Okay, which they don't arrest you for this crap, but the bottom line is something so that you don't have to, you know, look over your shoulder for anything, for any fines or anything. Let's see. Did you have to get your home kitchen inspected? You're in Minnesota. That was the question there. Alex, in Minnesota, it's not a requirement. Some states it is. Most states it isn't.
You just have to, there's like a,
it was a questionnaire.
Questionnaire.
It was very simple. That was just for cottage foods. And right now we are actually licensed as a retail mobile food handler.
Okay. So we can you stepped up. You actually got licensed as a vendor.
Yeah, that was just this fall.
That's congratulations, though, because that's a big achievement.
We have a commissary.
We're legit.
The Victoria says, do you make your caramel corn in the oven?
No, we do not.
No, it does not bake.
It's
different than a lot of caramel corn because it's still...
It's more al dente.
Yeah, it has chewiness. The crispiness of the corn is still in there and the pretzels when we do that one. But the caramel, it does set up, but it's still got some chewiness to it.
Okay. Did you see Art asks, okay, here's a challenge for you guys, North Carolina barbecue flavored kettle corn. I'll buy that if you get it right.
Dude, Steve can work on it.
I made the best North Carolina style barbecue on the planet.
Don't get him started on the barbecue thing. Yeah, he'll be here forever.
I'm actually from North Carolina originally.
Stop now.
Hell, so you know about it.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I make an amazing North Carolina barbecue sauce.
He does. He really does.
And if I could get that in kettle corn, yeah, I would make some real money there.
Hey, Lewis, I want to know what you mean by this. You said you get more pop per cup of corn. Is that
expansion rate? Yes.
Is it with the butterfly? Is that
it? Depends.
It depends on the variety.
Yeah.
Yeah, but the brand, I know there's better quality corn because I tested probably, I don't know, 14 brands, 13, 14 brands. And I found two that really gave me most of the kernels popped every time.
We only use organic popcorn.
Okay.
So our expansion rate is a little less than other more commercial popcorns, right, like a monster mushroom or a monster or any other kind of commercial mushroom varietal is going to be have a greater expansion rate. And you'll get more cups, if you will, per batch. Your volume will be bigger.
Yeah, you're going to make more money if you don't do organic, but we find
the flavor is better, but it also fits with our paradigm.
Yeah. I mean, it was our goal from the beginning with this to kind of is organic if possible, you know,
right.
Whenever possible and local, whenever possible,
local and as clean as we can make it.
Right.
And that really our market here in St. Paul, I mean, there's definitely demand.
People want that here.
Yeah. I mean, including ourselves. I mean, it was like, this is what we want to eat. And we knew there were plenty of people around here that felt the same. And we're an uber local company. I mean, like our neighborhood local. That's our biggest focus is literally our neighborhood within St. Paul.
I also make all of our own seasonings. So like the cheese blend, I combine things that I purchase that are clean. You know, they don't have a lot of chemicals in them. We don't use any artificial colors.
Really?
We don't use artificial flavors. Nope. Everything is natural. And if not organic, then just not, you know, non-GMO.
Right. Like that. We've got vendors. We've got vendors that have created huge niches for themselves by doing what you're doing, by going quality all the way. There's one in Ohio, and I don't know if you know from Vendors United, Caitlin. And Caitlin is, she does everything just high end, as quality, as local as she can source it. And it brings it, one, she has to raise her prices for it when she did that.
Right.
But nobody complains because her stuff is dynamite every time.
We've never had a complaint on our prices and we're not super cheap.
And we actually went up on them the second year by $1 a bag.
Didn't hear one word about it.
For the regular, well, it was kind of a stroke of genius. That was, the second year, because the first year that bag was like $5, and it's just about a gallon of popcorn.
Right.
You know, volume-wise. And then the next year, we raised it to $6.
Or 2 for $10.
Or 2 for $10.
And that was the key to selling more.
And we sold a lot more popcorn the second year. We sold a lot of, you know, 2 for $10s, especially to the repeat customers who already knew it was great and that they had the Reelock bag in there. It would keep for weeks if they didn't need it.
Yeah, it would never really last around
that
here.
That doesn't usually last that long around here. But
no, I would imagine not. Dan is a vendor, does YouTube videos. He's a great guy. I want to say this first before I tell you what he said. Dan, I am thankful that he's still on this side of the earth because he got COVID, really, really freaking sick, and is now back at it. And so I'm thankful.
You're better, Dan.
I'm thankful that Dan is he's a huge asset. It helps a lot of people with advice and stuff. He asked about popcorn kiosks in malls. Have you thought about doing anything like that? Even if it's pop it at your commissary or wherever in your garage and then take it over to a mall and add it to somebody else's kiosk or create your own kiosk.
It's not really a paradigm we're looking to explore. We would prefer to do events and then just sort of sell if we can, you know, out of our home.
I would pretty much rather smash myself in the head with a hammer than go into a mall anyway.
I'm with you. I'd rather help.
It's just me. I hate malls.
I'd rather help three buddies move homes.
And I hate malls
on a sunny, good fishing day than go to a mall. So Victoria has under the cottage food laws, can you ship your product to other states? Yes and no. Depends on your state. Minnesota, you can. No, Minnesota, you have to say in-state. It's called interstate sales if it goes out.
You in Minnesota, you can't even ship it to your neighbor across the street.
No, not right.
You have to. You're supposed to sell
physically.
It directly.
It's called direct sales. Yeah.
Right. Either at a market or take it to, or they can come pick it up legally. Now, you know, people have shipped popcorn before, but it's not something we really want to do a lot of, shipping popcorn.
I get you.
It's just, I mean, there's a lot, you know,
there's always more you can do. And you can also kill yourself trying to being everything to everybody. If what you're doing is working, there's no reason to take on all, you know, mall kiosks, even though it's a great idea. It just doesn't fit your plan. Ronald says, can't wait for the Louisiana guide. Ronald, if you'll email me, ben@vendorsunited.com, I will give you Louisiana guide before anybody else because I'm done with it. And Louisiana is pretty cool. Let's see. Profit margin. Jay says, what is the profit margin? Do you care to share? You don't have to be exact with your profit margin and show tax returns. We're not even going to ask for them.
Taxes.
What the hell?
I'm not drinking more. Start talking about that. Basically, we take our costs and we triple it, and then I usually add a little more on top of that because you know you got. I mean, there's a lot of work involved, you know, and setting all this stuff up, and I mean.
We spread it out. So let's just say we have an expensive bag of popcorn, like Cha-Cha Churro, at $6 a bag. But we have a cheaper bag of popcorn at like the classic, which only has two ingredients, butter and salt, or ghee and salt. Obviously, the classic is cheaper, but the... The Cha-Cha Churro is more expensive to make. So if you average it all out and even it all out, we are making... at least $4 in profit on a bag out of a $6 bag.
Right. And that's net. That's I call it net profit, but realistically, there's time.
That's what we pay for our time.
There's a labor of love, and it doesn't pay for your time right. because, you know, it's like somebody asking me how much profit's in a hot dog cart, and you go, yeah, but I got 64 hours in the build. And you know what I'm saying? So,
yes.
And so you have to take that into account and figure up what your time value is worth. So, I like where your profit margin is. There's a guy, a friend in Vendors United. He's been vending a long time, and he is funny as hell. But he'll tell everybody that his profit margin's, you know, 3 times, which is pretty standard in the industry. 3 times, and he'll go plus some, like Steve just said. And because he sends me stuff separate, he'll send me like. Because he's anal retentive about his numbers. He knows what every napkin, if somebody breathed too hard, he charges, you know, he puts that down as a fee. You know, he's got everything in there. I had to change a tire. I'm spreading that out over the next 6 years. He's got everything in his numbers. And he ends up being around 5.5 times. And wow. and that is great because you need to be in many things. And it may be just one type of item you carry that you're 5.5 times, but it helps leave you wiggle room for when you go to buy ghee or you go to buy Madagascar vanilla and they've tripled the price on you.
And they do.
And you got 84 orders to fill. So I love that you do that. I love that Steve said 3 times plus.
Found another 2 or whatever.
Well, and to be fair,
ask me next year.
The pricing model I shared with you was for the cottage food bags, right. which really was more of a learning process than a profit process for us.
Right.
The kettle corn business, like a straight up bag of kettle corn, is significantly cheaper and the profit margin is much higher. So, and we're just venturing into that. So, more to come. But we'll keep the 5 times in mind. That's a very good tip.
Lewis is in. No, I wasn't saying it for that reason. I wasn't saying you're doing it wrong. I was happy.
Make money. I'm not going to disagree with you there.
I was happy that you were doing 3 plus. And so I just was pointing out. Plus, I've been drinking bourbon with Steve and pre-game show. Lewis says we sell our 18x8.5 bags for $6 all day long. I too do 2 for $10. You know Lewis. He's in Texas. The guy is good at what he does, and he constantly is wanting to learn new tips and tricks. I love it. And he applies them and he tests stuff out. Not 85 things at once, but he tests stuff out. And then he changes up and he figures out his path. Let's see. Keith Gillian says, this is painful to watch because I'm a popcorn addict and I'm not allowed to eat it anymore.
Oh, I'm sorry. Man.
Yeah, he's, I don't know what you call those type of people, but it's not a name I can say on here. I'm just messing with Keith. I love
Keith. It's very sad. That's true. Keith, I want to thank Keith for helping sign us up for OrderGrubNow.com the other night because I was trying to go through the sign-up process and it wasn't going anywhere.
You know what? I need to tell people. I'm glad you mentioned that, Steve. OrderGrubNow.com, if you sign up there, it's free, okay? You can do your online orders for your business, for your cottage food business. And if you want information on cottage food, homebakingprofits.com will give you more. It's like a mini course and you can, in most states you can start tomorrow. That's how quick you can get started. Today, if you're watching this in the morning, but we're live right now. It ain't morning. Let's see. how do I get the guide on you're talking about the Oklahoma legal ways to sell what state? Okay, Jan, email me ben@vendorsunited.com and I'll send you Oklahoma's. I'm done with it too. Let's see. I bought a van that I use exclusive for the business. So with the van payments and all combined with the food cost, non-cost, I'm around 45% cost. That's great, Art. I love the fact that, one, you're keeping up with it. Two, just so you know, you can. We're going to give away some stuff tonight. But just so you know, anything you buy equipment this year, depending on what it is for your business, even if your business is a sole proprietorship, you might be able to get, with the federal law on the IRS tax laws right now, 100% tax credit instantly. So if you're going to be paying taxes, this is a great time not to pay taxes and deduct that amount from the taxes owed because you invested into your company. Whether that's a big dog cart from Hot Dog Cart Store, or it's a new kettle corn machine, or whatever it is, no matter what you decide to do, just keep that in mind. If you have an accountant, or if you can look up in, I was almost said Yellow Pages, I dated myself, Google your local area for accountants and just call and ask, go, look, can I buy a kettle corn machine? Can I buy the yellow bowl? Hey, do you care to do this, Payshee? Tell us about the yellow bowl. Tell us about it.
It's like a dollar store bowl.
It's the best bowl ever in the history of bowls.
It's super bendy. And you can pop popcorn in here or toss popcorn in here. And then bend it a little bit to fit into a bag and toss it in there. This is actually how we popped every single bag of cottage food popcorn that we made. It was tossed in this bowl. Yep. With the seasonings, one at a time.
One bag
for 2 years.
For two years. Yeah. I should have looked up the numbers of how many bags we did that way, but probably a couple thousand.
At least.
You know, this. A lot of people think that the American dream is like a lottery scratch-off, and the American dream is the fact that you can gain knowledge and then actually apply the information you learn and test out trial by fire, kind of like y'all did, where you had to go actually read codes to figure out what Minnesota said about your codes, and then to stick with it. And then when the good equipment quit, y'all didn't go, well, guys, we're closing up for 3 weeks. We lost our – y'all didn't open a GoFundMe. You broke out the Whirly Pop. Four people are going to get that tonight. I'm going to give four of those.
We popped Dee and Momo, our roommate at the time.
Yeah.
Popped. Well, she wasn't a roommate then. She came over to help. But they popped over 100 bags, bowls worth, in the Whirly Pop that day.
What?
One at a time. One batch at a time. One bag at a time.
For Cinco de Mayo.
Yeah, because the machine we had, the countertop machine, cracked out on us about a third of the way through the job that day, and we hadn't. I mean, it was either. I mean, we freaked out. Trust me, I was like, "Oh my God, we're screwed, and we're done, and we're not going to be there." And you know, for about 20, 30 minutes, probably, and then I was like, "Nope." I went in the cabinet, I out of the cabinet, I slammed it on, put it on the stove, and I looked at her, and I was like, start popping.
There was a lot of swearing.
We got a lot of popping. Yeah, there was a couple of words in there.
I would have had more than a couple.
It was kind of like being at the docks.
I can imagine. It's overwhelming.
It was not pretty. And it wasn't pretty doing it either because it was grease everywhere and popcorn everywhere. And
9 hours in front of the stove.
Yeah.
Wow. Wow. Yeah. And you know what, folks, if you don't believe me, if they sent me pictures of all this progress over 2 years, there is a photo of the Whirly Pop in their kitchen over the stove.
Oh,
they,
yeah.
They literally had a breakdown and had to go back to the Whirly Pop. The Whirly Pop works good, though. It's just slower.
I wish it was 30 times bigger. I would buy a huge one and power it myself.
It finally crapped out Sunday.
Did it really?
We finally,
we broke it.
We were popped. Was it Saturday morning or I think it was Saturday morning.
It's a blur.
Yeah, it's all a blur right now. We just finished all our holiday corn. We still had a couple of tins left for people to pick up. And we popped some in the big machine. I had to crank it back up Saturday morning. And then I realized, I was short on one other flavor or something. I was like, we're doing the Whirly Pop, which was already starting to wear out the gears on it. So we got to order a new top for it.
Love it. I love that you're doing it and that you didn't just hang up the towel, throw in the towel for a few weeks. You freaking just broke out more, you know, the bowl and the Whirly Pop and go back at it. I love it.
I can't stand it.
Gail, you are correct in some states. Some states do not allow commercial equipment. Of course, some states don't ever check you. Right now with COVID, they never check you. In fact, the problem is getting vendors approved in the states where they have to be approved. So just vend. The worst that's going to happen is they're going to go, hey, you ain't supposed to be having that fancy commercial unit. Do you know that there is no state code in all 50 states? This is my small rant. There's no state in all 50 states that has anything about what commercial really is. Commercial is up to the manufacturer. It's a word that we apply to stuff to give value. So I can say this is a Diet Pepsi, or I can say this is a commercial Diet Pepsi. 'Cause it's all BS. That's it. It all comes down to BS. So you can go get stuff that isn't listed as commercial that is commercial. And you'll typically find that on Alibaba or AliExpress. You can buy a huge, huge oven to do the mini donuts in. Okay, they're called toasters. Okay, conveyor belt toasters. You can buy that for $300. It doesn't say commercial on it nowhere. It ain't commercial. It's a residential. That's it, because they don't want to warranty it like a commercial piece would be warranted. So they call it residential. But it's a commercial unit. It will last you for years. Just think about it that way and know that there's no code in America for commercial. There's no testing procedure to see, this is a commercial Diet Pepsi. This is not a commercial Diet Pepsi. I'm smoking right now commercial cigarettes. They last longer.
They're NSF.
They're fancy. Yeah. NSF approved cigarettes.
Yeah. NSF. NSF, another scam. Because they created ANSI, they created rules, and then they created them being the only people that can approve those rules.
Yep.
Yeah. Don't get me started on that.
I hate them. I have said too much before, and they are lawyers, and they have lawyers have threatened to sue me. I hate them. They're scum. That is anti-capitalism because basically it's monopoly.
It's crony. Yeah. It's cronyism.
Crony capitalism. Bull crap. Lamar says he'd have more than a couple words when you were talking about cussing a minute ago. Let's see. What else I got? I'm going through these comments. We do dogs and lemonade, but can't cover the winter very well. I'm thinking specialty popcorn and gift boxes would be a great take on orders over the holidays. Absolutely. Great. There's popcorn you can do, cotton candy. We got vendors sending pies out, yeast breads out. We've got vendors doing bagels. Bagels are so cool to make, and you can create cool toppings for them. You know, like sesame seed topping and there's a vendor in Texas that's doing rice topping, just some kind of jasmine rice on top of it. Just kind of cool.
Oh, right. Okay.
Yeah. So
yeah, this is our holiday tin.
Look at that.
With greenery from our neighbor's tree.
Yeah, we've hacked down
half the tree. We stole it.
We gave her a free 10. I just took it this morning. I was like, this is because we chopped your tree down. She was trying to bend one of the lower branches down so I could clip off a little bit, and she just broke the whole thing.
I didn't mean to.
Yeah, she put the guns on it. And so,
do you take orders for those? How does that work on your team?
Yeah, we finally got around to setting up a website. We did it on Square in November, I guess, right before Thanksgiving. I started working on that. Before that, we would take orders, you know, basically via email or whatever.
Just Facebook email messenger. Or by hand.
Yeah, sometimes.
We would take orders for our holiday popcorn at the farmer's market in October, and people would have faith enough that we would deliver it 2 months later. And they would even pay me in advance, which I can't believe they did it, but they did. And that's how we started. Really, we started with the email list is a big deal. Having that email list to market to, we just ask people, hey, would you like to be on our mailing list? We'll give you a free coupon.
Hey, and y'all, just so you know, Payshee and Steve have given me a fantastic article on email lists, creating it, why to do it, how to do it the correct way. They're good at it. I have yet to share that.
Ways how to do it. I'm not sure if it's the correct way.
Well, but if it works, it's correct. So... it may not be the only correct way, but it's a correct way. So what I'd love is, I'd love it if I had more time in the day, but I have yet to send that out. In fact, they sent me another article, and I sent that out before that one because I was like, oh, this one's cool. And so anyway, that is going out. You'll find that at learnhotdogs.com. If you're on the email list, you'll get it. This is free information that Steve and Payshee are sharing with us. This is their experience for over 2 years, culmination of knowledge that you get for free. It'll save you a lot of time and effort on learning curves and trial by fires. You won't need to have any burn cream, and you can do this quicker. Let's give away some stuff and then we'll close it out. We've been on here a while. Here's a random one for you. I love cheesecake. So if you live in North Dakota, guess what? Cheesecake.
Who the hell knows?
It may not be random. It may be how I'm getting the messages. Dean.
Anyone? Because I could eat one right now, actually.
You and me both. My wife's favorite cheesecake. North Dakota allows cheesecake to be sold because they allow refrigerated foods, temperature-controlled foods. No permit, no licensing, no anything. There's lots of ways you can go with this. Alex has a great question, if you don't care to answer, and we'll call this the last question, and then we'll go. I'm going to give away these units. Alex says, do you get most of your business through Facebook?
Yes and no.
Maybe. That's called a maybe.
Right. Well, we a lot, yes, especially this season, this fall and winter, because we weren't at the farmer's market in the summer.
Right.
Most of our business and our email list and a lot of our Facebook followers came, you know, through being there that first year, especially.
Yeah, at the farmer's market.
Because she was there pretty much every week that first year.
If you give out samples, then you ask for email. Sign up, give their kid a free sticker that says Payshee's Popcorn with their name on it.
And we gave them what we call our Viper card.
Right.
Which is, if they sign up for the email list, it's our very important popcorn eater registry card. And not long, but it sticks in the head.
You buy 10, you get one free.
Buy 10, get one free.
I love 11, it.
This the card's called This One Goes to 11. And so once they buy 10, they get the 11 free,
right.
And they love it. And yeah, we sign the back of it, and we get little squares back there. And we did that. And the biggest way we built that list, though, which is in the thing I wrote, is the first year towards the end of the season, we made up some of that caramel corn with the chocolate and all that stuff. samples, and we took it to the farmer's market, and she was handing those samples out, and people were like, oh my God, I want to order a box of this for Christmas now. We were like, nope, we can't even order it yet. They just tasted it, and they're like, oh my God, I want it now. We're like, you can't order it yet. You can sign up for the email list, because the only way you're going to even get a chance to buy a box
is
if you're on the email list. We only marketed it to the email list.
Oh, smart.
It's the only way.
Smart.
So we signed up quite a few people that first season by basically extortion through their taste buds. And it worked. And we sold, you know, we were like, we're only going to make 100 boxes or whatever. And I think we ended up making like 80. And 10 we gave away to our crew.
Right.
Who helped make it. But the other 70 were sold. And they were like $30 a piece. They were like a cake box with, yeah, we had beautiful bows. I don't know if I sent you this photo.
You didn't send me that one.
I'll have to do that one. I have an article about the Christmas corn the first year.
Yeah.
I'll send that to you. I should have sent it already because it's Christmas season, but that helped build that list big time.
So here's one final tip, and then I will stop talking. Don't ever use the super expensive vanilla in the kettle. It will just burn away, and it's a waste of money. So
we've been experimenting with that.
There's my,
it's not working.
It doesn't work. You can't use it in a big kettle.
So we're still going back to the drawing board on our new, because we turned the churro into a kettle corn, and we've been trying to put the vanilla in the kettle, and that kettle is just
doesn't work. So too hot.
Too hot. So we're still working on it. But anyway,
we'll update you when we learn it. We will.
We will figure it out eventually.
I love it. I'm going to put you on the spot only once, okay? And then can you see the chat from where you are?
No. Okay.
Like the actual chat rolling by.
Mm-mm.
Okay. No, I don't know if I could bring it up.
But I may not be able to put you on the spot then.
I could. I mean, no. All we see is the checkout home baking profits rolling by. So I don't see. There's a way to chat.
Yeah, I'll do it. I never like doing this because then it looks like I'm playing favorites. So what I did is just pick names at random. I'm going to pick another one right now. Okay, so here's what you need to do. We're giving away a bunch of stuff, five things, four Whirly Pops that you saw. Pull that up again, Steve. Show us the Whirly Pop. I'm gonna put you on the screen solo. Hold on just a second. That way they can see the whole thing. That's a Whirly Pop.
This is a well-used Whirly Pop.
Yeah.
It's not new.
This is a worn-out Whirly Pop. We got to replace the top of it because the gears are basically worn out.
It's doing cottage foods at your stove in your kitchen. And how long did y'all use that before you were able to go to a machine?
We bought the machine first, actually.
Okay. Well, we had this in our kitchen. I mean, this is before we were,
in business. Popcorn. Okay.
Yeah, we were making
this is it. How we made prototypes.
Yeah, that became the spare tire.
We still do it. If we're testing out a new flavor, that's what we're doing.
And yes, it's our spare tire.
But that is the go-to. If this machine breaks, we can keep in business. Steve loves using this in the bowl.
We just used it.
The bowl.
We just used it Sunday to make some bags that we forgot to make in the big machine. And we're like, well, we only need 10, 11 bags. We'll just do it in this.
All right. So let's give the first one to Ron Lother. Ron Lother gets the first Whirly Pop. I picked people I didn't know, and I know that may not be fair, but I know some of these are already vendors, and they're going to go, why are you sending me a Whirly Pop? I don't need a Whirly Pop. But they don't know, do they? They may break down. The next one, Todd Tanhill is the second one. And what you need to do, keep this in mind, write this down, ben@vendorsunited.com, ben@vendorsunited.com. Send me your name, address, phone number. I won't use that or sell it or anything much. I'm just kidding. I won't give it to nobody. I won't even put you on my list. Just send that to me. I'm going to send you a Whirly Pop brand new through Amazon. Okay? Jan, I think it's Jan Rogers. I can't read my own writing. Jan Rogers gets the third one. Candace Mitchell gets the fourth one. And the fifth prize is the bigger prize, the one I sent out the email with the, I don't remember the name of that machine.
It's a Great Northern.
Carnival King.
Carnival King. Jessica Foster gets a Carnival King.
It's a nice machine.
Jessica Foster. And,
yeah, it's a very good machine. Very good machine.
The at least if you get in the business, you'll have a Whirly Pop as your spare tire. If you are dead broke, your Whirly Pop can make you money because it has for Stephen Payshee. Absolutely. And you can make this work. There is no reason not to have money. I've got daughters doing the cottage food stuff, and one of them's almost got her PhD, and she's having to do home baking. Guess mm-hmm. Oh, you do too, Steve?
Yeah.
She's got a master's and she's working on her PhD, and then COVID strikes. She's at home, she with two kids, and she's making freaking money doing home baking profits. I sent her the course for free. I didn't charge her. Well, I gave her a discount. It's my daughter. Friends and family coupon.
Great.
Yeah.
Five percent.
Yeah, I think it's less than $10, but anyway, you will you can change your life if you have a friend or family member, somebody from church, somebody from a social group, somebody that's struggling. Here is Stephen Payshee with proof that you can make a living from your home, from your kitchen. Can you show one of those bags of popcorn behind you? Is that why they're there?
Yeah. This is our large, which we get these bags from what was it, Poly Bags LLC, same place Grape Sweet got all his bags.
Okay.
This is the, I think it's the 9x24 plane that didn't have any logos on it because we put our own stickers and stuff on it. I'll show you that up close. See.
That's a $10 bag.
Yeah, it's 2 gallons of popcorn exactly.
And then, how much popcorn kernel is that?
It's roughly. about 2 cups. A little less than 2 cups.
Of kernels?
Yes. Yeah. Trust me.
Oh, I'm bad with math. I have an English degree. Sorry.
I'm the one that tracks all that stuff. this is a smaller bag. We actually got these bags from a different place locally. They hold just under a gallon. This is the $6 bag.
I love it. I love it.
This is good stuff.
Which
rotten peas. I make this mix myself.
From scratch.
Yep.
Yeah.
You must be talented in the kitchen.
Oh yes. Yeah.
Like I love it.
This is one of the things that's toughest for us is that because we're always trying to do stuff organically or clean or whatever, we look for the stuff out there and it ain't there. So we always have to make it from scratch or figure out how to mix it, you know, in a way.
There's an art to that though. That's an art to create stuff. Just like I love to bake and cook. My wife hates it, but she has that mind that can taste something and tell me immediately, this tastes like crap. Or tell me, you know what, this would be better with a little cumin.
That's very helpful.
She can pick out flavors that I can't pick out. Like I usually go, I need to know what does this need? Like then I'm Googling, you know.
Yep.
Anyway, Jessica.
She's one of those bakers that she could sell baking stuff if we had time for that. she will research like 10 different, you know, baking recipes for the same thing. And then in her mind, recalculate it on, combine them all, and it'll work.
It's hard to write it down.
No, I need step by step, draw the dotted lines.
I don't do bacon. I'm a savory. I can cook. I mean, I can grill, barbecue all day long.
Let me. I'm gonna pull up my camera, but I want to show you. My wife for my birthday got me. I'm gonna go to solo here, but she got me these pans from 1800s. These are cast iron pans. I have no idea why they ate so little tiny back then, but they're loaf pans.
Those are hand pie pans. They're great.
And I used them for the first time today. I have the round ones too, Payshee. And I did. Why is that still? There we go. Now we're back. So I did a Irish recipe, old fashioned, like 17th century old fashioned pound cake recipe, which has like four ingredients. Most of it's butter. In fact, there's more butter in it than all the other ingredients combined and doubled.
That sounds like a good recipe.
And I used European butter. So I used an Irish butter that's like 86%. You know, fat.
Very yellow.
And I freaking, it came out so good to me. It wasn't sweet enough for my wife, but I drink bourbon, so anything sweet. You know, I can lick the cat's butt at this point, and it's sweet.
Okay, that's too much information.
I'm just kidding. anyway, it's I've seen him do it. That's why I did that. it just is freaking, it's delicious to me. I put a strawberry on each one, and they're little tiny things, Payshee. They're like this big. I'm not good at doing the math. I have to actually have some directions, and then I can tweak and stuff. I don't have a problem tweaking, but I always follow the directions first.
It's all about technique.
I think that's awesome. I thank you for sharing. Several people have asked, how do they get their prizes again? Email ben@vendorsunited.com. Vendorsunited.com. In fact, you know what? I'll put this up for you. ben@vendorsunited.com. And if you don't know what Vendors United is, go over to it and look at it. ben@vendorsunited.com. And with your name, email, and... I don't need your email address and phone number. I usually need your phone number for Amazon, so they can, if there's a problem, delivery type deal. But it won't go on any other list, and I'll send those out. Those winners again are Ron, Lowther, Todd, Tam Hill, Jan Rogers, Jessica Foster, Candace Mitchell. That's cool. Thank y'all so much for taking the time to share. Could you do me one more? Can I ask one more question? I know I've kept you on here over an hour.
Sure.
I want to ask you one more question. Somebody that's brand
here for days with you.
I would. You were, before you ask this question, I just want to say thank you, like everyone else does when they're on here, of course, for the inspiration. Dude, I've watched pretty much every damn video, and I know it's a lot of them. Yeah. Trust me. And I started watching back when she came up with the idea for Payshee's popcorn. She's like, "Do you think we could actually, you know, make a living doing it?" I was like, "Yeah, why not? Let's do it." And yeah, because I kind of just, let's just roll the dice. Why not? But then I started looking up, you know, street food and all this kind of stuff, and I stumbled on this crazy redneck from Tennessee. And I read your book like everybody else.
He did.
And I was like, wow, we probably could do that, you know? And so we started doing it. And so that the inspiration, of course, we stumbled on Greg Sweet not too long after that.
Yes.
And watched all of his stuff 5 or 10 times. But I just want to say, if anybody out there, if you have, you know, popcorn specific questions, you know, find us, Payshee's Popcorn. Yeah. You can find us, you know, Facebook.
We'll help you.
You can email us, Payshee's Popcorn@gmail.com. I've had quite a few in the last couple of weeks reach out and ask me questions, and I've, you know, done my best to answer them.
What was your question, Ben?
Yeah, no, go ahead.
I thank you for your kind words. I'm glad you would take the time to share. I know you're busy, and I know it's life, and there's always something else on Netflix, right? So I want to thank you for that, but I also want to ask you, for somebody brand new, is cottage food a great way to start, so that, or if they're struggling, they've lost their job because of COVID or whatever reason, they cussed out their boss, and they're at home right now looking for a job, what are the opportunity? Is this a legit opportunity? Can anyone do this? That's what I want to ask, an honest opinion of where, what you've done.
Yes, anybody can start this. If you want to do it.
Would you do it again?
I would do it again. This is the way you learn food business. It is the perfect way to get into it without a giant investment. If you can afford a $1 dollar store yellow bowl and a Whirly Pop and some popcorn.
You can't have our bowl.
No. It's very simple. That's just one way to do it. But yeah, cottage food is the way to go, I think.
It is a brilliant way to start. And you can do it, you know, at your farmer's market. You know, there's lots of places you can sell. Mm-hmm. Right now, you could sell out of your house. Mm-hmm. You know, you what you learn by doing it that way is all of the details that, I mean, if we, the Department of Ag, when they turned down our initial plan to put, you know, we were actually going to put that counter unit, that Great Northern unit,
right,
on the back of our gym truck.
Well, they did us a favor by turning us down because it was an unsustainable way to sell popcorn.
It simply would not have produced enough popcorn to do live events anyway. So we would have built this whole thing out and made a mistake, but they basically forced us into doing cottage food by turning that down.
Right.
And that was the best move ever.
Yep.
Because then we learned that machine would never keep up at a lot of events, just not big enough. But, you know, when you're doing it at home, you've got, you know, you just, how long is it going to take for us to make 150 bags? And that's, you do it, you back the time up, you do it, and then you show up to the event, and you just got bags, you just take money and hand bags. The hard stuff's already done. Mm-hmm. And, I mean, there's a lot of guesswork and all that stuff, but you learn a lot of stuff doing it that way about your costs and about how much time it takes to make this stuff.
It's a way to dip your toe and then your foot in and then your ankle. And then your leg, and then you're knee deep in it.
Right, without diving in, you know, buying a huge kettle corn machine or whatever. I mean, it's fine if you got the money to do it and that's what you want to do. But it's a great way if you don't have a lot of money to start out to get into it and figure it out.
Make your mistakes.
While you're doing it. Yeah, screw it up.
Without a huge investment either, without a lot of risk. And honestly, I think you're risking more doing nothing.
Agreed.
Absolutely. The people, that's a great point. People are always afraid to start because they're afraid to fail, right? But they never really think about what's the risk of not doing something, of just sitting still.
I mean, you guys are asking us, do you think we're experts at this? So you're asking our opinion, and we just started it from
I love it. I love that you're humble, but number one, that you share this, that 2 years or 2+ years is a lot of experience packed into there. There's been backup and pump moments. There's, you know, like Steve said at the very beginning, I'm going to give you the shorthand version. So I really appreciate y'all. Thank you so much for taking the time to do it. I do want to say to Dan, I didn't see your comment. Sam said something, and then somebody private messaged me. And anyway, the bottom line is, yeah, I'll do it. I'll be on there with you. Just send me the information. Somebody talking about going live with Dan, the hot dog man. And so I just want to thank y'all for sharing, because these are ripples. Like, I'm not going to cure cancer in life. I'm not going to do something major that affects a wide sleuth of people that everybody knows me, and they build six statues that can be tore down later. I'm just me, right? And so I've even got kids that ain't even graded me real high, you know. They're adult kids and thought, you know, if I was your dad, I could have done it better. And so I these are ripples, and I appreciate the fact that you would come out here, throw your stones in the lake of life, and create ripples for people that will be affecting people 100 years from now that you won't even know about. Your ancestors, you know, your kids, great kids, won't know about this, that you've affected people's lives because you put out knowledge that changed others' lives. And whether they go into cottage food or go into hot dog vending or whatever it is, it doesn't matter. This inspires people. And I love the fact that you're willing to give of your time and do it. I beg people a lot to do this. I don't get a lot to take me up.
Yes, thank you for having us.
You inspired us big time.
By the way, you've got one of my books on the way. I don't know if you've got it yet.
Oh, I can't wait. You write so well, Steve. You write so well.
I've been there about an hour, but the USPS is running behind these days, I think.
Well, oh, yeah. I got a check in the mail. Somebody owed me money. It wasn't a lot of money, but they owed me money. They swore they had mailed it. I got it today. It's postmarked September 11th.
Oh, my God.
Wow.
Wow. That's crazy.
So anyway, I love you guys. Thank you so much for sharing. And I wish you the best going forward, and I look forward to more information as we go.
Absolutely.
Merry Christmas.
Yep. Merry Christmas. Happy holidays, everybody.
Yeah, happy holidays. Thank you. Bye-bye.